self-punishment is a big way to get out of fear.
Yeah, that's what fear. You were talking about. That.
And that's why it's good that Jane brought those things up, because many of you ladies do have a large degree of fear about seeing yourself. And as a result, you either revert to self-punishment or the punishment of others. When self-punishment becomes so painful, you, and then you go to the punishment, and that hurts too much, you go back to the punishment yourself. And then when that hurts too much, you go to you.
And I'm sure God's going, okay.
Well, you know, each one breaks the law as well, the law of love, and so each one has a penalty. So the problem with self-punishment and the punishment of others is that you will experience more pain when you do either of them. And that many of you are not actually addressing emotional causes from your childhood. You are actually addressing...
Many of you are not actually addressing emotional causes for injuries in your childhood. What you're actually addressing is things that you are continuing to infect your soul with right now. So in other words, you take an action that's in disharmony with the law. The action taken in disharmony with law causes a penalty, which the soul feels, and because you've now become more emotionally sensitive to what the soul feels, you'll feel that probably more painfully. And then you have a big cry about that or whatever and release that and maybe go through a bit of sorrow about the action and, you know, ask for forgiveness about the action. But you don't address the underlying emotional cause. And so the next time you're placed in the same situation, you take exactly the same action. You break the law again. You go through the penalty of breaking the law there. You feel the pain of that. And it's just like penalty, law, penalty, penalty, law, penalty, penalty, law. All cycling around. And where's your causal emotion?
Not touched.
It's not touched at all. It's way over here.
It's like we're living in effect and consequence, not cause and effect.
Exactly. You are living in the effects of your choice to break the law every time. And the problem with that is that you keep breaking the law, breaking the law, breaking the law, breaking the law. You're hoping that there's no penalty either. Like I was saying to Mary recently, it surprises me so much that a lot of the people around us still believe that rebellion is going to get them somewhere with God. Like, how do you believe that? Because all that rebellion does is have a penalty associated with it every single time. That's all it can do, right? And what we're often trying to do is we're breaking the law, and then we want God to take the consequences of our breaking the law away. And when we're truly repentant, of course, that can happen, but unfortunately we're not receiving more love, we're not changing in our heart so that we no longer don't break that law. Does that make sense? And the main reason why we're not receiving more divine love is primarily because we don't have enough desire for it, and the desire is insincere, and we don't have any faith, and we don't want to address any of these issues with God. And so we're left in this place of self-reliance of which we cannot get out, and we're continually breaking the law and having to pay the penalty, and then we say, oh, this divine love path is really painful. Well, you're not on the divine love path for a start, and secondly, if you're in so much pain, it's because you're breaking the law. If you gave up breaking the law, you would be in less pain. And, you know, the pain, many of you are yet to realise that the pain of these childhood experiences are much easier to deal with than the consistent and continual pain of breaking law after law after law, right?
And so, there's a difference between crying about a causal, like releasing a causal emotion, because you changed after that. And I see a lot of people breaking the law, like, for example, Nat, just that example of, you know, you were saying you felt humiliated from having the feedback. I see a lot of people then go away and go, I must have been humiliated by my dad, I'll have a cry about that. And I think that kid themselves that they're actually working on their soul, when because they're ignoring the truth about the interaction, which is actually I was just given some loving feedback and I have some pain about that. That's probably because I just broke a law. What was the reason I broke the law, that might lead me to a causal emotion. people just come up against emotions and go, oh, that I'll just attach that to a parent and cry about that. And it kind of becomes this real, the path loses meaning, and that's why people don't change. Like, we know heaps of people who haven't changed for 5 years.
If you examine yourself over the last 5 years since you've known us and are really sincere about it, how much have you actually changed? For many of us, very smitten, right? And the reason why is because you continually break the law and then blame your parents for it.
And
Matt, if you use the mic.
Yeah. Sorry.
Yep.
And just in that example that you gave, Mary, I've felt that, you know, like I've been in a seminar, you've been really direct with me. It's hit me to the point that I've had to get up and leave so I could cry about it. At some point there, I didn't know even what I was crying about.
Yep.
But later on when I was reflecting, I was like, right now I feel embarrassed because it's exposed shame in me, it's exposed truth about myself. There's all these things that I didn't want people to know, but most importantly, I didn't want to know.
Yeah.
Irrespective of them, I didn't want to know.
And none of that gets you to the childhood emotion
and
that created the wrong behaviour
in
the first
any,
place.
And not in any in that stage did I say to God, well, where is this coming from? What's caused this in me?
Exactly.
I'm just in the overwhelm of it. And like I said to you before, I sit in the overwhelm and there's no surrender to wanting to know what God's truth is. And,
yep. And this is where, I just feel if the majority of people who heard about God's laws had even an intellectual effort to follow them, they'd bring up emotions quite naturally. If they were humble to their emotions, they'd release a lot of the causes that caused them to break the law. But you can't expect to have no pain and suffering while you're breaking law. You just can't expect that. And you also can't expect to feel good about yourself while you're breaking law. You know, the good consequences that come to the soul are the result of living up to the law, not from breaking them.
Yeah.
So you're never going to feel good about yourself after you've broken the law, ever. And the more laws you break, the worse you're going to feel about yourself. That's the reality.
Yeah.
The more laws you break, the worse you will feel. And so if you feel bad about yourself, it's because you're breaking quite a lot of laws. Right?
Okay.
Now, a lot of people then go down the track of self-attack, but that's breaking another law. See, once we truly love God and love God's laws, what we will do instead of wanting to break the law is we'll want to address the problem.
My guides have been trying to tell me that too.
Yeah.
I'm struggling with
it. Always. God's always trying to tell you. And your guides are always trying to tell you.
Yeah.
But oftentimes we're so intent on using the same old patterns that we've always used. Yeah.
And that's the other thing I feel about a healing group is because Jesus has engaged his own healing since coming back, since returning, then he can sit here and just talk to all of us. And because he's talking from a place of actually having done it, he inspires and begins to invoke healing in everyone. And that's why, to not get caught up on the modalities, like you really, if you just live the example, you begin to heal and heal yourself and heal others just by interacting.
But if I can just point out, though, with the healing, who's doing the healing?
God.
Well, yeah, if you're on the path to God, it's God's love that would be doing the healing, right? Now, what's your role in that process?
To want it.
To actually receive God's love, so that the healing that God's love can give can actually do its work. That's your process. The big problem the majority of you have is you don't want to engage that process. You don't want to engage the process of wanting God's love.
That's what I'm trying to say. And because you have, then you just talk to us about it and everyone goes, yeah. Yeah, and it starts to open people to their own process. But that's only because you wanted it first. Like, it's like me teaching divine truth as compared to AJ teaching divine truth. Who's more effective? Him, because he's done more. And so if we want to heal people, we have to do the thing. because that's the only way anyone's ever going to open up to their own process.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
even if you don't touch them.
So you'll get to the point where healing will be so simple that just you have to be in somebody's company, that's all.
Yeah.
That's all that has to happen.
Yeah.
So as you develop a greater desire and faith and have more faith, you're already engaged in that process.
Yeah.
Right at that moment.
Yeah.
So anyone you come in contact, they will automatically start feeling something.
That's right. Yeah. And this is why I say to you that developing faith and developing desire for God's love, prayer, those two particular things, faith and prayer, are the most powerful things that you can engage in your healing process. Like, you are going to have to be sensitive to emotion in that process, because you will have feelings. You will have feelings. Some of the feelings will be, I don't like God, because like Igor said, you know, God's a sadist or whatever it is that I might believe. And then you have to go through those emotions. You will. And you want to do that because you still want God's love and you have faith that you can get it. You have faith that you can enter this relationship with God. If you don't have faith that you can enter a relationship with God and you do not have a desire for God's love to enter your soul, when you hit an emotion like that, you'll go, oh, I'm giving up. And this is what I'm saying to you. Without this relationship with God, no matter what you choose to do, you are going to be on the natural love path. You are going to have all of the... It doesn't matter what thoughts I've taught you. It doesn't matter that you know about the spirit world and you know about, you know, divine truth and you know about all these other principles. It doesn't matter at all. None of those things will matter because it's only been engaged with the mind. It's not a soul-based action. So they're just all thoughts, and in the end they'll do nothing. They'll do nothing for you. Does that make sense?
And sometimes that's a deficit because it sets up an arrogance in a person too.
Yeah.
It's not in their feelings about that. As well.
That's right. Yeah. What we find happening a lot lately is that people are going, oh, yeah, I know that. Oh, yeah, I know that. And I'm going, you know that. Like, you got no idea. You got no idea what you're saying. Because if you knew that, you'd be doing it. And you're not doing it, so you don't know it, you know. And the only, the reason why we want to tell ourselves that is because we're just telling ourselves a heap of things that we've come to an understanding of in our mind that we agree with in our mind, while at the same time in our soul is a whole set of other completely opposite belief systems that cause all of these mind-based beliefs to never enter our soul. You know, tomorrow I'll be doing a series of a few FAQs with Luli, and the subject we're talking about is how the soul works. The majority of people who've heard about divine truth still do not understand how the soul works. You cannot have a false belief and a true belief in your soul. You can, on the same subject at the same time, but you can in your mind. So the problem is that many people hear, they love what they hear, yes, there's a bit of resonance in their soul that it feels good to hear these truths, but because there's no change in the soul about, for example, the attitude they have towards God, they'll never know the truth of it. So, for example, you hear, God is a God of love, God is a God of love, God is a God of love, God is a God of love. You hear that over and over again. How many of you believe it? Like, Mary doesn't even believe that yet. Isn't that true?
Pretty much. If you examine my life for evidence.
Yeah. And examine the feelings that you have towards God. Yeah, fear that you have with God about engaging God's love. Don't believe that yet. Why? Because there's an unwillingness to release an emotion that would allow for that belief to enter the soul. That's as simple as that, as it is. No?
Does wanting to believe that's true help you at all?
Certainly. Wanting to believe it, certainly. But you've got to be very careful, because hoping that something is true is different to knowing that it's true.
Absolutely.
And a lot of people who hear the divine truth hope that it's true. Most of you hope that it's true. A lot of you hope that I'm Jesus, even. You've got no idea because you've never resolved the question. You've never even addressed any single emotion related to resolving the question. You've skipped over every one of them. Right? And so then whenever I do something that you think's a bit strange, or maybe he's not Jesus, Or if I say something that you think is wrong, oh, maybe he's not Jesus. Of course it's going to come up because you haven't resolved it. Right? And it's the same with every other truth. You haven't resolved hardly anything about God at this point. Like if you had it, your life would be very different to what it currently displays with regard to your relationship with God. You haven't resolved it. What you've done is you've allowed the thought to enter your mind and you hope that it's true. They are the two things that you definitely have done, but you are yet to resolve it emotionally inside of yourself whether it is true or not, because you've yet to have the personal experience.
And that's developing the faith to create the emotional experience with prayer.
But it's also... Sorry.
Go on.
It's also this... I'm totally in love with this idea of just honouring the law. If I know enough intellectually about God's laws, about free will, about truth, about all these things, and I decide to honour the law, then I have the emotional experience of, like, experiencing my emotions, growth, connection with God, just because I decide to honour the law. And that grows my faith. And
so that can be just an intellectual awareness to start with, and then the choice to not rebel and say, I'm going to honour the law.
Yes.
Yes.
And then that brings the emotional experience.
And the choice is an exercise of your will. Yeah. That's an exercise of your willpower, as the saying goes, right? You can choose to not disobey all the time. You can choose to stop rebellion. You can choose that. Even though you might have feelings of wanting to rebel, you can still choose to not rebel.
It feels compulsive sometimes.
Well, it can do sometimes, and often you are compelled to rebel. But if you chose differently, you would find the emotions come up much more readily.
If you take the example of the group where a number of you, I think you mentioned this before, came to the first group and went, yeah, I don't really like what's happening here. I'm just not going to go back. Now, if you decided to honour the law, you would go,
you wouldn't
hang on, I can feel something's out of harmony with love here, and I'm an equal member of this group. Why wouldn't I speak the truth about this?
There and then in the situation.
If I believe the truth is loving, is always going to bring opportunities for healing in everyone if it's spoken and honoured, why wouldn't I do that? It's the same. Remember, Sam, you told us the story about the three women in the session with Denny, and you went, I'm out of here, I'm going for a run. You know, if we decide to honour the law and say, I'm going to speak the truth, you can bet your bottom dollar your fear's going to get triggered.
Yeah.
You're going to grow, but you'll also get to see the results of acting in harmony with the law positively, which will grow your faith, which then helps you more on the journey. That's my experiment lately. It's pretty amazing. Honour the law. Freak out, grow.
Freak out, grow.
Is it what, like Mary was saying to me frequently, like, oh, it's all too hard and it's all too terrible and whatever else. And I said, but at some point you've got to say to yourself, well, okay, do I love God enough? Do I love, like, do I want to grow enough that no matter what happens and how freaked out I am, I'm still going to do it? And do I honour his law enough to say, no matter what comes along and no matter what compromises I'd like to make, I'm not going to compromise on the law of love? Do I do that?
Yeah. And I had to go, hang on, I really... And it helps being reincarnated, probably. Like, I have a strong feeling that these laws exist and are loving and that God is loving, even though it's a bit confused because of the whole reincarnation thing. But if I had to really look and go, hang on, I really believe in this. So what's stopping me living by this? It's only the excuse that I'm afraid. I'm just saying, yeah, I believe it. I believe it so much I'm even willing to talk to other people about it. But when I get to the situation, I go, oh, hang on, I'm afraid now. So I'm just giving up. And I'm not honouring the law. So how can I grow? And how can I really say I believe that honouring those laws are going to bring me to more love? Because I'm actually saying, well, I believe that, but fear is more important to me.
And when you dishonour the law, as I said before, the painful consequence is instant. So now you're experiencing additional pain that you didn't have to experience before. If you'd chosen differently and chose to honour the law, you wouldn't be experiencing that pain right now.
And it's bad pain when you know the law. I know the law. So I know the law. I'm coming up to fear and going, oh, well, scrap the law. I just want to avoid fear. And then I have to live with the consequences of, like, feeling that. Then there's shame, there's a loss of self-esteem, there's all these yucky consequences.
And they're saying, oh, I don't have any sense of self-worth. I said, no wonder. You're breaking the law all the time, and then, of course, you're going to feel bad. Like, how can you feel good? How can you feel good when you break
the law? And I had to go, you're right! Oh!
So even feeling bad about yourself oftentimes is a result of you breaking the law and feeling its consequences, and then feeling disappointed with your actions. But like, all of that could have been avoided. Like, what I see happening more and more is people could be avoiding huge amounts of negative emotions in their day-to-day life, but they don't. And these emotions have got nothing to do with their childhood injuries. They've got everything to do with the choice they're making at the time to break the law rather than uphold it.
This is another thing I started saying to myself. I've got the choice. 3 minutes of sheer terror, 3 months of pain, regret, you know, processing.
And sometimes longer, right?
Waiting for another opportunity to face the fear, you know. So whenever I'm in a situation, there's this, okay, I could have 3 minutes of terror here. This could feel really out of control. Or I could just back down and live in this feeling about myself, about my life, about growth, about I didn't even love that person then just because I didn't want to feel afraid.
And every time you break the law of love, you're going to feel guilt.
Yeah.
And that guilt's going to be with you and with you and with you and with you and with you until you process through it. It's going to be with you. Like, there are things that I'm so glad that I didn't break the law about years and years ago, because knowing how sensitive I am, I'd probably still be feeling guilty about it. You know what I mean? Like, it's much easier to not have to feel guilt at all. And this is where, like, I feel that the group, as a group, you have this ability. If you want to engage the process of healing with others, you know that there's a lot of things that you can engage with what we've already discussed, right? And I just want to,
yeah,
we've talked about desire to regret, ignoring truth, lust, love, desire to be error. We've talked about most of those things now, I think.
Addictions and fears, yeah.
Yeah, we've talked about all those, so that's good. I just feel that the potential for your group is great, but not if you're going to keep running away from things or running into things all the time, running into the same walls. Like, I often think of the laws as they're like walls, you know, they're immovable objects. Now, I know many of you would like to move them and have them somewhere else, but these laws have got our immovable objects. And what I love about them is they all have this beautiful, loving consequence if you follow them, most of which you're completely unaware of at this point because most of the time you break most of them, right? But they have these beautiful, loving consequences when you follow them, and they have these really terrible negative consequences to give you some feedback when you're not following them, right? And even those consequences are loving. Even the negative consequences are loving. Actually, the entire system is completely loving. And I respect that. That's the main difference between myself and yourself, is I've come to know the laws and I respect the love that's in them, right? And what I find is humanity generally is rebellious. We're like rebellious children who come up against mummy and daddy's law and get some kind of consequence as a result. And we are outraged at the fact that mummy and daddy think they should be able to give us a consequence for breaking a law in a negative way. Right? That's what we believe. And yet, with our own children, we would never stand for that particular behaviour generally. And yet, with God, we are constantly like a rebellious child. Right? And we can't expect to, and particularly when you become emotionally sensitive, you can't expect to continually do that and not feel the terrible consequences of that in your heart, you know? And you're going to feel bad about yourself while you keep doing that. You're going to feel terrible about what you're doing, and you're bad about yourself all the time, and all of these things are going to happen as a result. But if you choose to follow the law, and you honour the law above other things, because you honour God above other things, even above yourself, right, you will find the emotions will naturally come up. Now, if you do that as a group and refine yourself, you will be able to connect more, firstly, to spirits who are on the divine love path, who have a lot more healing energy and power than a natural love spirit. And secondly, because you're more open to God, they will be able to actually use your heightened condition to have a greater impact upon a person that you're attempting to help, right? But if you choose to remain in the current place and just experiment with different modalities of healing without changing the condition, what's going to happen is that in 10 years' time, you'll have no further benefits than what you're already having. Right? And perhaps some additional consequences for teaching untruths and for, you know, perpetrating those untruths upon others. So, like, to me, it's pretty obvious what I would be doing if I was a member of the group. Does that make sense? Yeah. Courtney?
I just need to make sure I said something truthful last week too. I was explaining that they gave an example or an analogy about how the love increases. As we increase our love, like from, say, a first sphere state, I was saying it was like a pipe that carries water.
Yeah.
And it's got a certain diameter at first. But if we elevate our love to a second sphere state, it multiplies that diameter by about 10
yep.
from the first one, and 10 on top of that one for the third sphere. Is that yep. correct?
Yeah, yeah. It's exponential yeah. in its yeah. in its ability to give. But remember that the love that you're transmitting to the person is not God's. Mm. It's your own. But because you have a greater capacity to transmit that love and a greater energetic capacity in your own self, then more ectoplasm can be used to try to assist the person in the physical, and also much more love can flow out of you towards the individual. You'll have a lot more understanding. You'll also have a lot more openness to what the emotions are within the condition of the individual that you're trying to help. See, at the moment, many of you are so shut down to all different types of emotions that if somebody comes along, many of you would be totally clueless as to what to do. And so you lay somebody on the table and start doing something. You'll be guided by spirits in terms of what to do, of course, remembering that all you are is just a vehicle in this particular place, right? And you'll be guided by spirits what to do, but there's a certain limit to what they can do through you based on the condition you're in. Now, from day to day, your condition changes, right? Some days you have more faith than other days. So more faith means better condition, therefore more love can be transmitted through you, more help can be given. Other days you're feeling really terrible because you're holding on to some of your own emotions and you're holding on to some of your own false beliefs and so forth, and you're feeling stagnant. As a result, your faith is down a bit, and as a result, on that particular day, you'll be less effective. That's naturally going to occur. But as you progress and grow through these experiences of addressing the emotion, holding on to the law, making sure you practice the laws, and also focusing primarily on prayer and faith in your day-to-day life, then you'll find this continual growth and continual expansion of your capacity to understand everything going on around you as well. They'll have, our spirit guides, your spirit guides, will have a greater capacity to help the individual you're trying to assist and a greater capacity to work through you as a result of the changes you have made. But if you make no changes, or you continually break the law and have to deal with more consequences, right? And even if you, like, for many of you, the course of the day is like this. You're going all right, then there's some kind of compromise situation that occurs. You break the law, right? Then you go through forgiveness or, you know, desiring God's forgiveness or whatever, or you go through a bit of repentance so it comes back up again. But what's the course of the whole day? Zero change, because the actual cause of you breaking law way back here was never addressed, right? And that can only be addressed by getting into some kind of experiences related to old belief systems and childhood belief systems. But many of you don't even want to go there because you've already had such an exhausting process coping with the consequence of breaking the law that you don't want to have the additional process of having to go back and find why you did it, right? And so you end up with this cycle in the course of a day like so, and then that day's finished and you end up the same as the start. And you think you've done a heap of processing or emotional work and you've done nothing except pay for the consequences of breaking the law, which you've now become more sensitive to. Now, that's great, because that means that you haven't degraded in your condition at least, right? But the outcome could be far better than that, right? And this is where I feel it's so important for you, the group. Again, like, the group's going to be as effective as each of you choose to make it. And if each of you choose to continue doing what you're currently doing, it's not going to go as well as it could, yeah?
Yeah, just some other feedback about when I sent that email, the first one, I tried to imagine having therapy from everyone in the group, and there was only two or three people that I felt that I would be comfortable to actually receive any kind of session from, and that was because of the projections I feel with you guys just interacting on this basis. So the addictions that I feel are the projections towards me, and for me to feel okay to have a session with someone, I need to feel just simply that they're owning those things. And if they're not owning them in our day-to-day interactions, then I don't feel safe to open myself in a trust situation where I put you sort of in charge of a healing process on my body. So I feel like for you guys, there's all this stuff that that Jesus has been talking to you about has to start right back at this self-awareness point of what's actually coming out of me towards other people, because that's what you're not owning. As soon as you start to own it, you're already in a better condition. And some the people that I was happy to, in my mind's eye, have a therapy session with, are not necessarily, you know, stand out in terms of their condition of love even, but just, well, they were in that they would own their injuries in a session, which does make them stand out in terms of love, I suppose.
So, I just feel there's so much potential, but it's going to depend a lot on your desire, and it's going to depend a lot on your sincerity with really engaging, God in the process, really. Because in the end, you'll just end up with the same as what any other group of healers ends up with if you don't engage God. If you keep doing what many of you have been doing in the past, you're going to think you're engaging God even, but not be engaging God.
Before the break, you said that more rapid growth was possible under certain conditions.
Yeah. And I've told you the conditions.
They were the ones that living in harmony with love, with the laws.
Living in harmony with the laws, but having a focus on faith and prayer.
Right, okay.
Yeah. If you think about the your day-to-day life and how much time you spend focusing on faith, prayer and living in harmony with law, I think, the average one of you would have to say that that's not been very prominent in your day-to-day life. Igor?
Just a question about prayer. God doesn't want us to beg for his love, doesn't he?
No.
Sometimes.
No.
Do you remember in that chapter of Through the Mists where we saw there was this huge description of, I think it was Siamedes, might have been Krishna, in prayer, where he was asking, it was at the magnetic corral, he was praying for God's love to come down and help him do this healing. And remember, it showed all of the aspects of, it was an effective prayer. And one of his huge qualities was faith. He had an assurance that he would receive the love. That's different from begging. That, there's...
And begging usually covers over quite a lot of addiction.
Yeah.
Like, if we're begging for it, then we have no understanding of God and God's nature, really. Because God's not some kind of, what would you call it, sort of megalomaniac tyrant who goes, I'm not giving you any. I'm not giving you. You got to beg. You got to beg.
You show me you want it.
God's not like that, right? If we have that understanding of God, then of course we might try to beg. But God's going in that moment, I'm sorry, but you just got the wrong understanding. You got me wrong completely. How can I give you my love when you've got me wrong completely here? You know, like get me right. Like, I love you, and you don't have to beg for anything, but you do have to be honest about everything. Yeah. Yeah. So having a longing and so prayer, you know, developing prayer, and will trigger every single emotion you have with God. Every single one. Every single blockage you have with God will be triggered through the aspect of prayer. So there'll be times when you'll be praying for divine love and you won't receive a single skerrick of it. How would you feel then?
That's what I've done. Why do you want me to beg now?
Exactly. And there it is. You know what I mean? There's the injury. What? You want me to beg? There's my belief about God coming straight out of there, right?
And the rage.
And the rage.
I'm not doing that.
You know, I'm not doing that. And this is the beauty, is that every interaction with God will challenge something in your belief systems with God. And this is why many people on the planet never engage God. Because every single one of their addictions at some point gets exposed, and they don't want it exposed. They want to hold on to their belief systems that they currently have, and they don't want to see that it's their belief systems that they currently have are dictating the relationship. That's what's dictating what happens between themselves and God. So this is why prayer is so essential. The beauty of this relationship with God is it'll challenge every aspect of your life. Every aspect of your life. It's unavoidable. This is how people who become at one with God can become at one with God without even being in a relationship, because it even challenges their concept of relationship, their concept of love, their concept of what it means to be with a partner, everything. It challenges everything. And without the challenge, if you think about it, without the beauty of that process, we would never sincerely arrive at a point of perfection. It would just be a manufactured intellectual state, which is where six-dimensional spirits exist thinking that they're perfect when they're away from it yet. They're a long way from it yet, because they're perfect in the way they display love to their fellow man, but they've got huge gaping holes in their relationship with God, right? And this is why focusing on the relationship with God is so important. I feel if you do that in the group and you focus on even developing things in the group where you're focused with your relationship with God and working your way through the issues. And how you do that is really up to you. Like, I don't feel any need to tell you how, even, or any of those things. I just feel like all I'm doing here is just reminding you of some basic principles of what the problems are, and then saying to you guys, you've got the opportunity now to either engage these principles fully or to avoid them, like you have been doing a lot in the past. You know, what do you want to do? What are you going to do? Are you going to engage them or avoid them? And you've got an opportunity to engage, and you'll find a huge amount of benefits. If you avoid, you'll have the same processes that you currently have happening in your life will continue to happen. And many of you will blame it on the divine love path. It's got nothing to do with the divine love path. It's got everything to do with how you personally are engaging God and God's universal system, which includes all of God's laws. And That is a key part of your development as an individual, but it's also a key part of your ability to fully realise your desires to help others. You can't sincerely help another person with something that you yourself are insincere about healing within yourself. Yeah. So you can't expect to do that. So how you as a group and how Corny as your leader engages that process, well, that's up to you guys, I feel. But my suggestion is, anything that you do personally and as a group that aids you with those particular focuses is going to have a great effect on your life and your ability to help others. So if it was me too, I'd be working on these addictions. I'd be having open sessions every week, you know, where we part of the session is what's the addictions you know that we see in each other. Yeah. Now, I wouldn't be focusing on the ones that you've already seen. You know, what I see groups get together and do is they go, oh, this week I realised this. Okay. That's something you realise. What about the 25 things you didn't realise this week that you could have realised, given the law of attraction and other events that have occurred through the week, that you're completely blind to? What about those? Now, if you get together and just share what you did realise this week, then I suggest you're feeding another addiction, which is the addiction of everybody agreeing, isn't that wonderful, and to go, oh, aren't we all
getting somewhere.
We're getting somewhere and all that. It's kind of addictions, right? Like, you will know when you've addressed something. You will not need anybody else to tell you. You will not need somebody to praise you for it, and because you will know. You will know in your relationship with God that something has changed, right? You won't need to feed any of those addictions. So I'd be focused on the things you can't see rather than the things you have seen this week, you know? And unless you feel that something you have seen this week definitely is something that a lot of other people in the group can't see, then I'd probably share it. Does that make sense? Okay.
How do you see the thing you can't see if you can't have seen it?
Exactly.
So is it...
The only way you can do it is... Go on.
No.
Is it? You were going to say...
Was I? I think I was, but by others pointing it out, sort of in some way, but they haven't seen your week either. Just
one of the things I said recently in one of the FAQs was that all help for your growth comes from outside of you. Outside of you. So if you're resistant to hearing anything from outside of you, you're never going to grow. Now, let's look at what's outside of you. What's outside of you? First thing that's outside of you is God. So you can get a lot of things from God. And if you're completely open, you'll get everything from God. Right? But let's assume you're not completely open. You'll get a lot of things from God still if you're sincere. Second thing, you've got guides. They want to tell you everything. Everything. They don't just want to tell you the things you want to hear. And in fact, they get sick and tired of telling you the things you want to hear all the time, because that just feeds your addictions. And that's why many of you don't hear anything from them, right? Because they're sick and tired of trying to feed your addictions. And they want you to get real with yourself and hear everything. And in hearing everything, there's a lot of beautiful things you'll have as experiences with these guides. So that's the second thing. Now, there's a few in the group, three or four of you, who are very clear mediums, if you wish to be. And if you remove some of the arrogance and judgment, you'll be even better with regard to that. And my suggestion is to use that as part of the tools that you have to help each other. The third thing, outside of you is the other people in the group. They will be able to see things that you can't see, right? So be open to hearing them. Instead of going, like you were all feeling when I walked in the room, oh, what's he going to say now? Oh, no, you know, that kind of feeling. That's not an openness to hearing. That's a feeling like, no, stay away from me. Stay away from me, right? That's the feeling. And now that's not the feeling you want to carry into the group, because if you have that feeling and other people have the same feeling, how is this group going to benefit you? You're all going to go, I won't hear from you as long as you don't tell me anything about me. I won't tell you anything about you as long as you don't tell me anything about me that might make me feel bad. Right? And so what do you end up with then? You end up with a mutual addiction society.
Just be a mute group. Like no one is saying
mute
anything.
Group or a mute group.
Yeah. A mutual addiction group is not very productive for your personal growth, right? So don't do that. Don't do that anymore. Make some commitments before you come to the group to not do that anymore. Right? That you're going to engage directly with each person what you feel their addictions are, and also be open to them sharing with you what they feel yours are, and doing it in the spirit of love that Courtney has given you some guidance
about last week, you know, that what kind of attitude you would have with each other doing it. Yeah. So that these are all methods that you've got at your disposal. Now, if you say, I recognise I have this addiction, then the addictions you see are fantastic because you can always work on them during the week. It's the addictions you cannot see that you want this group to help you with. Can you see that? Like the addictions you see, rather than talking about them all the time, write them all down and go away and work on them. Be sincere. Don't expect the group to work on them for you. It's not their role. It's not their process. It's not even their responsibility, right? So don't expect anybody else to work on your addictions for you, but enjoy the fact that your addictions can be exposed. You have a different a group of people who want to expose their addictions for a purpose. Do it. Expose the addictions for the purpose. And if you don't notice the addictions, and all of you don't notice anymore, then invite me along and I'll start you off again if you want, right? Because unless you're at one with God, you've still got some addictions, right? So unless you're at one with God, invite somebody along who might be able to assist you with the addictions you cannot see. But I suggest to you that it's going to be quite some time before any of you can't see some of the addictions that each of you have if you are sincere about the process. So that's the kind of thing I would probably engage. You know, you've got God, you've got spirit guides, you've got each other as a support network to expose your addictions that you cannot see. And it's the ones you cannot see, as you correctly point out, Corny, are the ones that are the most dangerous to you.
You can't heal what you can't see.
You can't heal what you can't see. Yeah. And you can't feel what you can't see.
When you talk about ectoplasm, is that what's coming out of us?
No, there's parts of our physical nature. And in fact, this is something, one other thing I would like to say to you. Many of you have no idea how healing actually works. Right? You believe you do, but you don't. So what I would like to give you as a bit of homework is this. Find every message you can in the Paget messages that refers to healing and how it works. And try to understand what it means. Now, can I give you a start of one message? Just to give you an example. This message was on 16th of May 1916. It's from myself. If you look at our site, you'll find it under Downloads, Paget messages. There is the actual Paget messages right at the top of those download section. If you click on that, you'll get a panel of the messages divided into each year. And this is in 1916, 16th of May. And it's from myself. How divine love may be called upon and used in the healing of our physical bodies is the subject of the message. My suggestion is have a read through messages like that. Find out about healing. You want to know as much as you can about it, right? And how it works. You want to. I would also examine there are passages in the Robert James Lee's material where some spirits overcloaked Robert James Lee's and healed his children, right? My suggestion is find those passages and read them and ask them what they tell you about healing. Do whatever you can about. To find out about the truth about healing from the perspective of divine truth, right? And what is actually going on. So that would be my recommendation, Sam, to find out about all those things, and then you'll start to question this idea of what's happening with the substance that comes from the physical form towards another. And what actually happens is a spirit who is powerful enough can use parts of your physical body that parts that you can't see but that are still a part of your physical form that they can use as energy to heal the other person that they're working with. Does that make sense? Now, what I would like you to do, rather than me tell you more, is to find out about that and what's all the things that are involved in that.
Okay, thank you.
I have a feeling you're going to tell me to find out about it anyway.
Yeah.
But I saw when Jane and Corny were working on Phil,
mm-hmm.
I saw two very distinct things happening for each of them, and I wanted to ask you about what it was.
Yeah.
For Jane, I could see her guide.
So did you tell Jane this?
Not while it was happening.
No. You told her afterwards?
No, I haven't seen her to tell.
Okay, no worries. See, this is part of the issue you'll face in the group, but continue.
Yep. So I saw a spirit standing very close to Jane, lots taller than her,
yep.
Beautiful colour of light going through her, what appeared to be her hands, but Jane was not actually touching Phil at that time.
Yeah.
Corny had a hold of Phil's hand, and there was something coming directly above him through his crown, like through the top of his head, and out of everywhere in him. And it was, I was just really curious to know if you could define the difference in that, because I'd never seen
that.
I'm not
going to say. Okay. I'm going to say this is what you need to experiment with.
And I never had a chance to tell you
exactly
that either. Oh, I did tell you? Okay, cool.
So these are the kind of things you need to find out about, right?
Okay.
And even if that means channeling some spirits to find out about it, like, see, this is all of what the group can engage. There's a lot of very interesting things as a group that you can engage if you have a passion to find out the truth. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Rather than somebody telling you without you being engaged in the process, it is far better for you to go through this process of engaging all of these different sources of information that you have in order to find out the truth about what's really going on.
Okay.
And I can explain to you what was happening for Corny and what was happening for Jane. However, and in fact, it's a great illustration of two different kinds of healing.
Yeah.
However, and this is something that as a group you need to find out about, the effectiveness of either.
And when I was watching it, I felt like there was two different things
happening. Certainly.
But, I've been known to make assumptions before, so I didn't want to make any assumptions.
Don't make any assumptions. Use it as a scientific method to go through and find out, using the different tools you have at your disposal, to find out what's actually going on.
Okay.
And each of you come to understand it. Inside of you, understand it.
Okay.
Because if you understand it, you're going to be far more effective in doing it.
Yeah.
As well.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Sam?
How can we minimise potential damage that might be coming out of us towards a person we're engaged with?
Well, you can't.
Whilst we're dealing with the addiction, if you know what I mean. Like, for example...
Yep. You can't.
Okay.
You want to, but you can't. So you need to understand that any state you're in currently is damaging every single person around you,
no matter who they are, and there's nothing you can do to stop this until you change. So can you see the importance of changing? There's the motivation to change. So don't stop
engaging your passions. What I'm saying is engage passionately the desire to change. Right? Engage your passion still, because it's your passion. It's going to help you change, right? But make sure you don't stop engaging that passion to change first. If I'd done that, like, I would never have met any of you, because I'd still be doing it, right? If I waited until I was perfect before I met you, well, we'd still be waiting, because I'm not.
So you would have heard the divine truth 4 or 5 years ago, like many of you have. You still would not have heard of it. So what does that tell you? I've engaged my passion even though I knew that there was refinement
that needed to occur inside of me. Engage it with humility. Engage it with the desire to learn everything you possibly can out of the experience and be humble to every emotion. If you're humble to every emotion, the least amount of damage will occur. If you're not humble, then you'll create the most amount of damage that you could possibly create. Right? So all you really need to do, you understand you cannot change what's coming out of your soul unless it's a real change. You can't manipulate it somehow. You can't make it be less. You can only sincerely address the issue right in that moment. That's all you can do. So do it. Many of you are not doing that. You're not sincerely addressing the issue right in that moment. That's what's causing the damage. Right? In that moment, if you could sincerely address the issue, things will change around you quite rapidly. But understand you cannot fix the problem using any technique or any other thing. You can't. You just can't. Give the idea up. You want to, because you have this feeling of, I have this sort of feeling of hopelessness sometimes, right? I've got so many problems. Oh, boy. Like, and then I'm told I've got to engage my desires. I don't feel like engaging my desires. I'm going to do damage. You know, these are the feelings we have. So feel them. That's humble. Be humble to those feelings. Feel them all, but still engage your desire.
Yeah, and I think what I was missing was really beginning
Does that
to
mean
sincerely.
My time's up?
Okay. Self-destruct in 10 seconds.
Sorry, then.
Engaging that desire to really know why I'm in this addiction.
That, see, there's the power. Like, that's the power. See, for majority, at this point in time, you're engaging a desire to not know. So that's very different. That's what causes damage. That causes a lot more damage.
That's what I was trying to say before. I feel like if you get the truth about an addiction and instead of denying or ignoring or beating yourself up about it, you start to engage, okay, this is real, why is it there? Immediately I feel more comfortable to go and lay on a table because I know that the person is owning more of what would usually come out onto me, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, so even if I'm not completely aware of what's coming out of me in that moment, just my intention to discover it and own it lessens the damage.
Exactly. Yes. Of course. Okay.
And it's really damaging.
When you're holding on to something that you believe is loving, that is actually unloving, because
then you use that on the person. Whereas if you're engaged in a session where you want to be shown as much about yourself as you do about the person you're working with, that's a whole different dynamic. Yeah.
That's great. Thank you.
So when the guides give you the impressions and it's just inspiration, they sort of...
Because
I get that and I just...
You ignore most of it.
I ignore it. So I'm literally pissing up the wind, my opportunities.
Yep. Yeah, you'd be surprised how many opportunities each of you are being given every moment that you're just throwing away. Opportunity to speak up, to tell the truth, to live in more humility, to honour the law. Just opportunity after... In the course of a day, many times there's 1,000 opportunities in the course of one day. Like, oftentimes it's minute by minute there's another opportunity, you know, and we don't take them for all sorts of reasons, and mostly fear-based reasons, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But if we were more open to it... See, your guides can assist you greatly to progress much more rapidly than currently is possible, as long as you're open to all of these opportunities that come up and just allow and go along with them and trust that these are opportunities that you need to do to develop yourself. And, yeah, like, I just feel like there's thousands of opportunities many times in the course of a few days that can be addressed. And your guides are beautiful, you know. They're constantly trying to... There it is again. You know, they're pointing at it. And you go, I don't want to know.
Shut up.
and of course, you know, sooner or later, after they hear enough shut ups from us, they go, okay, I'll shut up. Then you're feeling lots and lots of pain with no communication about its cause as well. And they go, well, you told me to shut up. Like, what can I do to help you now? And the reality is that, you know, they've all been assigned to you because they love you, they are interested in your nature and personality, they have similar desires to yourself, and they're in a far better state of development. So why wouldn't you listen? Like, why wouldn't you listen to them? They've got all your best interests at heart. The main reason why we don't listen is because we don't believe that God or our guides or anybody who loves us actually has our best interests at heart. And that is a false belief that we have about love most of the time that we need to address. And it's our false beliefs about love that are our mistakes. I keep saying this to people. It's not a mistake to have a lack of knowledge. You'll become celestial spirits one day and you'll still have a lack of knowledge. You know that, surely. If God's eternal and infinite... then even when you're a celestial spirit, you're not going to know everything. You have a lack of knowledge. It's not a mistake to have a lack of knowledge. It's a mistake to have a lack of love. That's the error, the lack of love. And you've got to give up this worry about what you know, and you've got to start worrying more about how unloving you're being. Does that make sense? Give up this concept, I need to know more, and start accepting this concept that I need to love more. That needs to become my goal. It's the lack of love inside of me that causes every mistake. From God's perspective, it's only when you're unloving that you make a mistake. You understand what I've said there? It's only when you're unloving that you made a mistake. Now, sometimes those mistakes are not mistakes. They're purposeful actions of unloving behaviour. But that's a mistake too from your soul perspective. To do that is a mistake. Your lack of knowledge is never a mistake. God has given this infinite universe so that you'll have a lack of knowledge for the rest of your existence. And why did God create it that way? Because God wanted to make it interesting for you. There'd always be something to discover. Otherwise you'd be bored, right? If you knew everything, you'd be bored, right? And even God, who knows everything, is never bored because God now uses everything he knows and creates more things. So even once you do, eventually, if you ever get to the state where God, of knowing everything, by that state, you'll know so much that you'll never be bored because you do so many things. But God's created this infinite universe, and we will continue to grow and grow and grow and grow in knowledge, right? And in love. But once we make mistake, from God's definition, every mistake is whenever you're out of harmony with love. Now, many of you don't realize that the mistake you're worrying about is nothing. And the mistake you're not worrying about is everything. Because the mistake you worry about are mistakes in knowledge, not knowing enough or not being enough and all these kind of things. God doesn't worry about all that. God worries about how loving you are. And when I say God worries, it's not a worry, obviously. But God, all of God's laws are about helping you develop in love. You know? It's not a mistake to not know things. It's a mistake to not love. And this is where your group needs to be focused. To see that the mistake is to not be loving. Every time you're not loving with each other, you've made a mistake. Every time you're not loving with somebody who comes along to be healed, you've made a mistake. Every time you're not loving with yourself, you've made a mistake from God's perspective. Every time you had a thought that turned out to be wrong, that's not a mistake. That's growth from God's perspective. When I say a thought that turned out to be wrong, you might have believed something. Like you might believe that, you know, everyone should have left feet. I don't know, some crazy thing. And in the end, you learn out that, no, that's not the case. And that's fine. From God's perspective, it was never a problem in the first place. But every time you choose to act out of harmony love, from God's perspective, that's a big problem. You break laws of the universe doing that. You can't break a law of the universe by having a thought that is out of harmony with truth. You can break the laws of the universe by having an action and a thought that's out of harmony with love. Can you see the difference?
You mentioned before about spirits masquerading, that to be more loving than what they are. Is it possible for them to, like, because sometimes I can see spirits and I can see really beautiful ones and then I can see really dark ones. Is it possible for a dark spirit to present themselves to me as bright as a celestial would? And my intellect is saying to me, well, no, because it's the love that makes them look that way. It's God's love that makes them so different.
It is possible for a group of spirits to project an image to you which is far beyond their own condition individually, right? But it's impossible to maintain. And when you feel their nature, when you can feel their love coming from their soul, you'll realise the disharmony and know something's wrong.
Yeah.
Right? For an individual spirit to project itself as bright as another spirit who's bright, impossible.
Yeah, okay.
It's possible for a group of spirits to do it,
yeah,
and project themselves as an individual. Does, yeah, that make sense? So it's possible for a million dark spirits to get together and muster up all the love they can possibly muster up in that moment and project themselves as one person of light.
Okay.
Right? Maybe to the condition of the second dimension.
Okay.
Right? But But, and that fools a lot of people, it fools a lot of mediums, but it's not possible to maintain it because they don't have the energy to maintain it.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Yeah. My guide has been talking to me about the importance of feeling, overseeing
and hearing. Overseeing. The problem with seeing is that your mind, which your sense of sight is governed, the pictures that appear in your mind from your sense of your third eye, if you like, your sight, are all manipulated, are able to be manipulated energetically.
Okay.
Right? So if I, as a spirit, if I know how to manipulate that energetically, I can manipulate that and make you think that I'm someone that I'm not. However, if you feel the person doing it, you'd feel the disparity immediately.
Yes. Yes, and I have had occasions where that's happened, where the image is kind of right, but the feeling is really
yucky.
It's exactly. Like, isn't it, who you're saying you are?
Yeah, and, you know, that's, it's very, once you feel, it's very easy to tell.
Yeah, okay.
So don't rely on the sense of sight, rely on your feelings first.
Yeah.
This is one of the things you'll learn through this healing group, is to start relying on feelings as a sense of sight. It's actually a way of seeing things.
Yeah.
Like, how do I see what's inside of you?
By what you feel from us.
By relying on what I can feel from you. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I don't have to see physically with my eyes anything.
Yeah.
I can close my eyes.
Yeah.
And still see.
Yeah.
Yeah. Close your spirit body's eyes and you can still see.
Yeah.
Once you can feel. You know who's around you.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Can I give you a bit of feedback now about the mediumship?
Yeah.
I feel like, and something I said to Denny as well when we had lunch with him, that you need to be prepared for the fact that you're in a lot of addiction in your day-to-day life with spirits. And because they like to maintain that, sometimes they help you with your gift.
Yeah.
And so as if you're sincere about dealing with your addictions, you might find that your mediumship ability seems to lessen because you get less help from spirits who are now helping you because they want to stay in unloving and addictive relationships with you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And also I feel because of the level of addiction in your life, trusting the feelings is important, but you have to be open to truth. Otherwise your feelings are going to tell you that everything's fine when you're in addiction. But if you're open to truth, then you'll be receiving more feedback on how actually this nice feeling I thought was good is actually a bit icky. And I can see there's a lot of areas in your life at the moment where you kind of have this pattern of striving for excellence in whatever you do, and you're a hard worker. And even with your mediumship, you get a sense of worth out of the gift, but it's actually not real because you're avoiding a lot of other feelings about yourself.
Okay.
And so I feel if you're able to look at those things, your mediumship will become much more reliable as well.
Okay.
But it might just feel a bit wonky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks,
Mary. It'll feel like you're not as good as you were before.
Yeah.
But you were never good as good as you think you were.
Yeah, I can feel there's some people not happy spirits, about you saying that. Because
you have spirits helping you with certain things, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Janine?
It was just a question about spirit guides and our ability to communicate with them. I haven't felt that I've had any natural ability to be able to do that. And but I have a desire. I feel I have a desire to really want to communicate with my spirit guides more often, rather than relying on other mediums to get the information that I want.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose I don't really know, other than dealing with my fear of spirits, how I can do that.
Yeah.
And then there's a question that I have about how do I go about dealing with my fear of spirits? I mean, I know I've tried.
I don't feel it's your fear of spirits that is the problem. It's your fear of truth that's the problem. You've got very large blockages to truth. And if you allowed yourself to work your way through the fear of truth, then you'd probably feel a lot more guidance from your guides than you currently do. You have a wall up that's pretty persistent wall regarding knowing truth about yourself and allowing yourself, because you're trying to prevent your feelings about that truth. So, and I see a lot of people doing the same thing where they basically place that they're so frightened of dealing with certain emotions that they like block off all of the emotional processing side of themselves by preventing truth from entering them, right? And this is one reason why you often feel a lot of anger in my company or when I've emailed things to you or whatever, is because the anger is the response to the underlying terror you have about yourself, your beliefs about yourself, that you're unwilling to face, right? So you're afraid that if you start to see yourself as you truly are, then you'll go into self-attack. Like, and so what you try to do instead is put a wall up so you don't hear anything about yourself, right? You just put this wall up. And the wall is a defence to everyone, and it's a defence to your spirit guides as well. They can't tell you anything. They can only tell you what... As interesting how you formed your question, because in it you actually said, they tell me what I want to know. Right? And I know that was a mistake of words because it wasn't what you intended, but it's interesting that it was said, because the reality is there is a feeling in you that you only want to hear what you want to know. Now... that is going to be a problem for you for communication with your real guides. Does that make sense? Your real guides want to tell you a heap of things you don't want to know.
So I feel that I want to know, but I don't want to know.
And no, so you think you want to know. At the moment, you think you want to know, but you don't feel you want to know. What's the feeling you have when truth is presented to you? You compare your thoughts, and this is something that each of you could do even as an exercise, is to compare your thoughts about what you think you feel to what you actually feel. And you'll find there's a huge discrepancy between those two places. To compare the thought that you have about what you hope or think about yourself compared with what is actually going on within you. So every interaction I've had with you in the past has resulted in your anger. So that should tell you something. So what does it tell you?
That I have a fear of...
Use a mic.
That I have a fear of the truth that you're offering me.
Okay, or you don't agree that it's the truth. It could be that too, isn't it? You feel it's not true.
Yep.
And how dare you say that? It's not true. Right. So that would even be called denial, wouldn't it? So you've either got denial or a fear of acknowledging certain things that have been said, right? One of those two things. So I would focus on those two things, denial and the fear. Do you see what I'm saying? Now, why do you get so scared when people present truth to you? What's the feeling you have? You can feel the fear that's present, or do you only feel the anger?
No, I feel the fear.
You feel the fear, but you respond in anger generally.
Well, quite often I feel that... when I'm in fear, the example you gave me before, when mm-hmm. you give me truth, that you feel a lot of anger from me.
Yep.
I'm not actually aware of the anger, but I'm really aware of all the fear.
Yeah, but if you could see your face and take a picture of it while I'm telling you the truth, and then looked at that picture, you would go, wow, that woman's very angry. You would actually, because you have this thing that Mary has too, that a feeling that's present is just written all over your face. You understand?
And we can't hide it.
You can't hide it back, right? And so it's just written, and that's not a bad thing. That's a very good thing. But it's just written all over you. So if I took a picture of you while I'm telling you the truth, and you could actually see that picture while we were having the discussion, you'd go, whoa, that woman's very angry, like, because you can see it in the face and the set of your jaw and almost gritting of your teeth as well. A lot of times happens. Now, these are all signs that there's a lot of anger. And the anger is about, obviously, one thing. So I'm not going to say what I feel that all of these things are, because I feel you need to work your way through having a desire to find out yourself. But there's anger present, and there's obviously fear present. So you feel your fear. So what is your fear about? Is the question I would ask myself. And you're honouring your fear. That's why you get angry. You're honouring your fear. You expect everyone around you to honour your fear. By the way, every time you get angry... for anybody, you are expecting everyone around you to honour your fear, what you're terrified of. And that expectation is what's coming out of you as anger. Right? So in that moment when you're afraid, you want me to make your fear go away. Why?
Because I don't want to feel it.
Exactly. Yeah, you don't want to feel it. So why don't you want to feel it? What would the fear do to you? If you felt it. Can I describe what it would do to you? It would make you feel powerless, stupid, humiliated. Can you feel some of those feelings? Yeah. And they are the feelings you don't want to feel. That's why you don't let yourself feel fear. But in denying your fear, you're going to get into a anger. It's unavoidable, right?
Yeah, I feel that anger from you as well, Janine. And I also relate to it because it's very similar to the feelings I have about fear. I feel that showing fear is like a it's going to lead to desperate humiliation and
people abusing you.
Me being completely powerless and at the mercy of everyone. And it's such a huge association I have with feeling fear that I used to do exactly the same thing. I wouldn't think I'm angry. But I was so rigid and so wanting nobody trigger my fear, it would come out of me like a big demand that is actually anger. But I also judged anger so much that I would never acknowledge that I'm angry, which is...
I do that too.
Yeah, because I felt like if I'm angry, well, then that's just horrible.
And that's just proof that I'm not loving.
Yeah, you know, like, I'm not loving and I'm not lovable, so no, I'm not angry. And that's why that exercise that AJ's suggesting about... what do I think I feel and what do I really feel is very powerful, because often what I think I feel is the thing that I think will get me love, will maintain people liking me. And that's so I tell myself a big story about that's what I really feel. But actually my real feeling is angry, and now I have to acknowledge that. Now I think that's horrible and I don't think...
And even that feels like a humiliation.
Yeah.
Do you know, a lot of the time I don't know what I'm feeling though.
Yeah.
And that is only prayer, and you want to open up your soul, right, to love.
Yeah.
And at the moment you're very close to love and you're very afraid of love.
Yeah.
Right? And you know that about yourself. And this is one reason why you lack sensitivity to what you're feeling, because while you're heavily trying to shut down yourself to love, you won't be open to what you sense. You won't be open to your feelings. Do you follow?
Yeah.
So this is where prayer again and faith in God and opening yourself up to God's love and actually going through this emotional process with God will help you greatly in opening up your heart to take the risk with God about love. And then as you do that, your sensitivity, the sensitivity of your soul will grow towards yourself.
Yeah. I feel that I pray nearly every day about...
I can't agree.
Okay, I feel that I was.
You think you are.
I am praying each day about opening up my heart.
True feeling coming out of you towards God is, I don't want to have to cry about things that I don't want to have to cry about. That's the true feeling coming towards God, going towards God. I don't want to know about the truth about certain things. Don't tell me anything that I don't want to know. That's the feeling coming towards God. So the feeling coming towards God is the prayer. You don't want to feel your fear. That's the prayer. The prayer towards God at this point in time is, don't do anything that's going to make me feel afraid.
So if I don't know how to pray,
You're already praying. You're just praying for the wrong things.
But I think I'm praying for something that I'm not.
No, see, you've got to give up the thought and start to feel what you're actually feeling. What you're actually feeling is, I don't want to experience certain things. That's your prayer. The feeling is the prayer. Do you follow me?
Just give up trying to be a good girl. And just, you know, like the good girl prays, the good girl, you know, the good girl goes, no, I really want God. And all of that, just go, no, this is what I really feel. And let yourself be there. And then God goes...
Can I describe to you what you really want? Yeah. You want God under your terms.
I didn't know that.
Well, you also want your husband under your terms and you want your children under your terms, so I don't understand why you can't see that with God as well.
But you judge it, Janine.
So you judge that.
You judge that. So then...
So how are you ever going to feel it if you judge it?
Yeah.
See, that's what causes you to not feel it. Now, I've said that to Mary, by the way, exactly the same thing I've said to you. She wanted me and God under her terms.
and I judged it. That's all I can say to you. It's not, you know, it just stops us feeling the truth of it. And then I got over judging it and went, well, I can't grow unless I face what's really in me. And I had a big cry about it, you know. It's, but you have to feel it for yourself. Like, it didn't matter how much Asia told me. While I judged it and I didn't want to know it, no, I held on to it for years. No, that's not how I am. I'm this good girl.
I'm a good girl.
Girl.
I'm not unloving. Like, yeah, and yeah, every single time that somebody sits down to talk to me about being Jesus, you just shut them down. You
that thing, that wall.
You do everything possible to get them out of what they want to ask. That's controlling, right? And you won't see your own controlling behaviour unless someone's brave enough to tell you. And at the moment, there's no one.
I wish you would.
Yeah, there's no one brave enough in your family. And that's Zenko's problem, is he's not brave enough to be honor honest and law. Truthful and honour the law. Yeah. He's willing to compromise the law constantly in the relationship so that he can avoid the anger, right, that he feels from you but that he's unwilling to express. And in fact, he's totally willing to support you in your anger rather than say, no, hang on a sec, this is angry again, and you know, you're breaking the law here, and what is it about this time, sort of thing. And that's what I've had to do with Mary. I've had to stand up for the truth, like stand up for the truth of what's really going on. And there is also this codependency between the two of you as a result of that. Like, you give him his nice feelings that he needs from the woman that he's desperate for, which is an addiction that he has. And the payment for that is that he has to agree with you a lot of the time and agree with the level of control that you have. That's his payment for it. And if he doesn't agree with that payment, then you don't give him the nice feeling. And there's the codependency. And the key for both of you is to be honest about the feelings involved about what's going on there and take these things to God, like to really confront them inside of yourself, be open to actually seeing them. When, like as Corny pointed out earlier, it's really hard to see the things you can't see, right? So we all accept that. We all accept that it's really hard to see. And somebody else who's next to you, living with you, probably can see them, yes? Now, it's not their role to tell you. They don't, you know, they don't have to tell you anything. It's a gift that they tell you, right? Does everyone see that? Mm-hmm. It's a gift. Like if we're together and Mary sees something in me I can't see about myself that I'm doing, it's a gift for Mary to share that with me. I can't expect it from her. I can't demand it from her because that would be both unloving actions. But when she gives it to me, I can appreciate it rather than go, what are you talking about? Oh, you know, like, you know, how dare you say such a thing about me? What do you mean? You know, like, and of course, when Mary hears that from me, what's she going to do next time she notices something? Well, last time I said something, it didn't go very well. So next time, what are we going to do? And this is how you can have created your existence to a degree, is you've created people around you not wanting to tell you things. Does that make sense? And as a result of that, you don't get to know them, which is a disservice to yourself, if you think about it. And why have you created that? Because you're afraid. You're afraid of knowing. And so the prayer that you've got going out of you at the moment is, I'm afraid of knowing anything about myself that I might feel is bad. Don't tell me anything about myself that I might feel is bad. Only tell me the good things. Now, it's not the good things that are stopping you in your relationship with God. So if you only hear the good things, how can your relationship with God grow? It's the bad things, the things that are driven by unhealed emotions and also driven by the rebellious feelings about breaking the law. Those things, the choice towards those things, that is stopping your relationship with God. So if I only share with you what I observe as the good things, and I do not share with you what I observe as the other things that are being broken, then can you see I'm doing you a disservice? Yeah. But you want that. That's the issue you've got to address, because while you want that, that's what you'll receive. You'll receive people around you telling you only the things they think you can cope with. But to be honest, the way you grow is by hearing all the things you can't cope with. That's how you grow. So set your prayer with God as, I want to know all the things that I can't cope with, that I believe I can't cope with, that I believe are going to be overwhelming. Set that as your prayer with God, and you'll find you'll have a different outcome. And also you'll respond differently when you hear the truth from people around you, and particularly from your family, you know, from Zenko. And there'll be less addiction in the process between the two. Does that make sense? Yeah. At the moment, the intention is very solidly set in this other direction, which is, please don't tell me any of the truth that I would be disappointed in hearing. Don't tell me. And in fact, the feeling of disappointment in hearing is actually a message going out to people. Don't tell me. I'm going to get disappointed. Don't tell me that. And so what do? Well, if they're in so much addiction with the woman as your husband currently is, they'll just concede that. They'll go, yeah, I won't tell her. And then any man you attract around you, most of the time will be the same kind of man who won't tell you. Right? And so you'll end up with only women telling you, and even those women will be afraid of you because of that feeling. They're afraid of feeling that hurt feeling that you have. And so they won't tell you either. And so what you end up having is a whole set of relationships all based on really facade. Yeah. So you can undo all of that quite simply by just having a different intention, using your will in a different direction, and being sincere about using your will in that direction. Yeah. And I feel that's a key part of what you're doing here, really. It's like, To become people who assist other people to grow, you are going to need to be a person who is completely free of the hypocrisy of trying to shut yourself down while you're trying to help other people grow. Does that make sense? And if you think about it, you've got a wonderful opportunity here to address those concerns, or not, depending on what you choose. Yeah. So I would suggest choose that. Look at the reason why you're so afraid of hearing the truth.
Thanks, because I didn't know I was.
Yeah. Well, every time you hear the truth, you get angry. So.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
I knew I was fearful, but I didn't know I was angry.
Yeah, which is an indication of how afraid you are.
Yeah.
Sam, the same could be said about yourself. Lily, same could be said about yourself. And Carol, well, same could be said about yourself. Yeah. Nat's in a different place. She's in a place where she thinks she wants to hear the truth all the time. But often it's an addiction.
Yeah. Can I just add something about blocks to hearing our spirit guides? I feel that our spirit guides are the people who are, like, they're not our guides by accident. They have a lot in common with us, and they've been with us for a long time usually. So the blocks I feel to connecting to our guides are around two different fears. Fear of truth, that you were just talking to Janine about, and fear of love. I feel there that I don't feel it's so much about spirit fear. Sometimes we block other mediumistic gifts because we're afraid of spirits. But our guides are so close to us energetically when we allow our fears of love, when we're humble to our fears of love and our fears of truth, that I feel they can communicate in a lot of different ways, even if we don't hear them or even know that it's them guiding us. When we open up to those two fears and allow them, I feel they have really good communication with us.
So perhaps if we can illustrate that for yourself, Janine, and maybe if you give the mic back to Janine. How do you feel about having an open-hearted love? What's the true feelings?
Maybe it's just in my head that is something that I would really love.
Yeah. So what's your viewpoints of love at the moment, though? What are you getting? Because what you're getting is what you actually believe.
Yeah, okay.
So what are you getting?
That I don't have an open heart and...
So what would be causing that, do you think?
Well... I kind of figured it was because my mum was exactly the same.
Well, that's partially true, but obviously your mum had the same fear of love that you do. But as Mary pointed out, there are two things, the fear of truth, which we've discussed. Now what I wanted to do is just discuss briefly the fear of love. Like, can you feel how afraid of love you are? Because at the moment I don't feel you can feel that at all. And yet you're terrified of it. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know that I am fearful of love, and I don't know why.
Yeah.
Often when we are like a lot of control in our life, it indicates that we're afraid of love, because when we're totally open-hearted and loving, we can't control anything.
And we don't want to. Out of control.
Yeah, we feel out of control all the time.
Yeah, I'm aware of the control issues.
Yeah.
And control is an indication of how much you're afraid of love.
Yep, okay.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
Simon?
Can I be in a space where I quite desire truth, but I don't desire love much. Like, I struggle with certainly. Accepting love.
Yep. Certainly, yeah.
Yep. Okay. Yeah.
Certainly.
I just feel that that's me pretty much.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what would cause the fear of love, do you think? So fear of love, obviously, isn't it?
Yeah, it's fear of receiving it, yeah.
Fear of receiving love, yeah.
Yep.
Why would you be afraid of receiving love?
I have feelings like I don't deserve it. That'd be too good to be true. Those sorts of feelings, like to be loved in a nurturing way. Or...
Yep. And why would that have occurred, do you feel? Just as an idea, intellectually.
I feel like probably expectations upon me.
Yep.
Exactly,
expectations and demands. So what happens when you receive expectations and demands during your childhood? What happens is you protect your heart from them, right? Shut down your heart. But the reason why you shut down is because these expectations and demands feel oppressive. They feel like oppression. And when they are associated with love, like a lot of times our parents say, I want this from you because I love you, and that kind of association, or they feel that at least. And you then grow up feeling that love means that you're going to have huge amounts of demands placed upon you. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons why you don't want to feel love, is because you feel love is going to demand all this energy from you that you're unwilling to give.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you feel it's going to take from you, not give to you.
Yeah.
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 And the reality is your childhood was like that. Yeah, the reality is your childhood was a childhood of being taken from an aspect of love and not being given to, but being told that that was love. And so now you're in this place where you just want to, anybody says they love you, you want to run 100 miles away, right?
Yeah.
And it's really hard to be in a relationship sometimes.
Yeah. And then I took that on into my teenage and adult, where I've realised, like, I've just pleased constantly.
Exactly.
To get...
To earn it.
Yeah.
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 And you know it's not love even.
No, not now.
Yeah, yeah. But even then it didn't feel like love when you had to earn it.
No, probably not.
If you connect to your feelings back then, like as you become more sensitive, you connect to your feelings about what that was like living like that, you'll begin to feel like, oh, I thought that was kind of friendship or that was happy, but now it feels like it was such a burden I was carrying.
When I'm around my parents now, I do feel that. I don't enjoy staying there too long. I'm honest with my parents about that. But
They're emotionally oppressive.
Yeah.
They can do it without words even.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is sometimes worse than the words, because if it was the words included, then you could say that's unloving.
Yeah.
But when the words are not included, you go, what's going on?
Yeah.
Same thing for yourself, huh? Can you see why your heart is closed to love then? Yeah. Well, rather than talk more about personal emotion, because I feel that, you know, these are the kind of things you probably want to do in your private time, discuss about some of them, but can you see how there's a link between relationship with God, receiving love from God, desire for receiving love from God, and a whole heap of unhealed emotions that might be connected with that? And how all of that's going to affect the ability to heal, the ability to grow, the ability to really engage the divine love path. And so I'd just like to encourage you in closing that you've got a great opportunity ahead of you. You've got a wonderful group of people who have some desires in a specific direction around you, who would like to exercise those desires. The key now is whether you're going to engage this sincerely, this process sincerely or not. that's going to be the key. And nobody can dictate that. No, but Corny can't control that. But that is something that you're going to have to bring to the table if you want to participate in this group. You're going to have to bring some courage to the table and start to address some of these issues. Now, Corny will give you some directions about of different things to do, and you'll be doing hands-on things, of course, in this process of learning, and in a process of learning about love and learning about truth and learning become more humble. And there are things, but there are things you can do privately. Prayer, faith, you can do privately every single moment of the day. You can develop these particular qualities. You can also privately investigate how healing occurs. How it really occurs from God's perspective, not from, you know, all the mundane books that we might be able to read, but from the Paget messages and from the Robert James Lee's material and from what I've already shared with you, you'll be able to determine how it actually works. And once you know these things, you can put them into practice with confidence. And that's what I would suggest the purpose of the group can be. Now, if you don't engage that, then, of course, Corny is just going to need to say at some point, oh, I just feel pointless having this anymore, and all of you will go your separate ways and you'll have lost another opportunity. As Anto pointed out earlier, we're receiving opportunity after opportunity, even in the course of a day, to make different choices and decisions, and you will have just rejected another opportunity, that's all. And God will offer you another one down the track at some point, but it might not be exactly the same. But I feel this is a wonderful opportunity to engage some of your own passions and desires in a certain direction and help you heal also in the process. And that's what I'd like to encourage you to do.
Thanks for your time.
Yeah.
Thanks for the house, and thank you to you guys for
the film
as well.
Yeah. Now, what we probably do with the film is that we will produce a basic sort of edit of it, and I don't know, depends whether... when you're going through the edit, whether you think it's worth putting on the net or not. It might not go on the net.
I think everything you said was pretty gold.
Yeah. But we'll see. We'll see what we decide there. We'd just like to encourage you to keep engaging the process. We love you. We're not going to share in this process with you. We're doing our own things, and we would like to see lots and lots of these groups start up with different goals in mind, where people, you know, embrace the group with the appropriate attitudes, and all around the world we'd love to see that happen. But what we have seen happen is that people embrace the group for a short period of time, it eventually gets full of addiction and eventually, of course, breaks up as a result. And what we feel is that you have the opportunity through your choices to make this different, this group different. And anybody who listens to this video has the opportunity with their groups to make the group different to what it's been in the past. So we have the ability to change what happens, but only through acting in harmony with the law. And the laws of love in particular. That's how things are going to change. So yeah. But thanks for your time, guys, today. And
Thank you for inviting us to
have a chat with you. And good luck for Corny. It's a challenge, you know. Yeah, and it's a challenge to when you're in a group to, you know, to challenge everyone in love, you know, rather but also help each other to not stay in addiction anymore. And if you find that there are things that you can't answer, write them all down, and then we're happy to come back. And if we can answer them, we'll answer them. But we're not going to come back regularly to the group. We want to see your desire drive rather than our desire drive something. Does that make sense? Mm. And that's what we feel is very, very important, is to activate your desire to grow and activate it in harmony with truth and love and humility and God's laws. And then things will grow. Yeah.
Something that you no doubt notice when AJ leads the group, there's a certain tone, isn't there? And more truth gets exposed, and more growth really has the potential to happen. And sometimes I see people want to bow out when Jesus is not present because they feel like that tone is lacking. But I feel like something that I've been feeling a lot about is, well, how am I setting the tone? Instead of relying on someone in a higher condition, I can set a certain tone by owning my emotions, by being aware of my addictions, by not acting or speaking in my addictions in a group setting, but allowing the opportunity to feel the response to not acting in them, or like also sitting here and seeing myself reflected in lots of you guys and feeling, wow, okay, thank you, law of attraction. That's something I've got to look at. And, you know, I feel like you've got an awesome leader in Corny because he's already going to set a tone that's pretty pretty high. But as group members, you can also be a part of keeping that tone. And I feel that when we have that desire, so much growth can happen. And you also, you want to come back to a group like that. When the tone is crappy and everyone's in their addictions, you're like, oh, do I really want to go? Is it really my passion? And you can start, you know, all these get out clauses just because we didn't honour the law last time and it felt yuck. Yeah. So I just encourage you guys in that.
And be brave enough to say when it feels yuck.
Yeah.
You know, just speak up, you know, like be truthful, you know, stop blowing wind up people's backsides, you know, and just be honest about what's really going on, but can't be honest from a position of love, not from, you know, anger or rage or other emotions, but just be honest about what you feel, what you observe. Don't avoid honesty with each other. If you can't be honest with each other, how are you ever going to be honest in the world? Like, it's a lot easier to be honest with people who you know, at least in part, that you sort of can feel a similar desire to yourself, of, you know, that's within them. It's a lot easier to be honest with them, trust me, than it is to be honest with the world around you that's steeped in its addiction. If you can't learn honesty here in a relatively safe environment, how are you going to learn honesty when you're living out there in the world in which, you know, we all want to eventually help change, which means we're all going to have to be in a state of truth with everyone around us at some point without being afraid. It's cool. Yeah. It's just so amazing, the potential. But how, like, many of you still have this sort of idea somehow that I'm going to change the world. Do you see it's changed much in the 2,000 years that I've been around? Really, honestly? Not really. So that's pretty much proof that I'm not going to change the world.
And you didn't die for our sins.
I didn't die for the sins.
It didn't work.
It didn't work. And when you did die, a lot of people gave up. They gave up on the dream. They went, oh, well, he's gone. That's it. We can't do it. And that's why we came back, to show you can.
Yeah. And it's going to need groups of people doing it, right? Initially the groups will be small because there won't be many people with the courage. But eventually, as more and more people do it, there'll be more people with the courage to do it. And then the groups will get bigger and eventually you'll have very large parts of the earth all just where you can live in harmony with divine love without fear of getting attacked in any way. And, you know, that is potentially the future, but only, it can't happen through one person.
And the more humble you are in this setting to what's in you, like instead of telling the truth to control other people, but just really feeling, wow, this is confronting for me, this situation, I'm going to speak up or whatever it is, like, there's just so much. Then you elevate your condition, which then creates a whole other attraction for this group, which can be even more positive and powerful. Like, imagine if 8 of us were in the condition that AJ's in right now. Like, what would we be doing? It would be, this room wouldn't have 20 people in it. But how awesome that there's 20 people. Like, look around. How awesome that there's 20 other people in this room who want the same thing that you want, which is, like, to grow, to know God, and to change the world, really, to help other people. That's a pretty awesome attraction. Even, like, that's a gift, I feel, and an opportunity that God's given us already. Yeah,
so take the opportunities.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid.
have courage. Feel that fear, Jane.
Be afraid and have courage.
We just feel that as a group, you've got so much potential. You know, you've three or four mediums here that are quite clear. You've got, you know, quite a lot of people who have a desire to help with healing and understanding the process. You know, and you've got, you know, Corny, who's really passionate about helping anybody. And, like, if you analyse all of those things together, there's a potential for a large amount of change in each of you over the coming months, but only if there's this personal engagement. Yeah. And, you know, the relationship with God always will come down to be the biggest thing that you need. And so that's why we wanted to talk to you about that first.
All right, Scott.